He has had innumerable citations of achievement, and which I will not even try to indicate to you. He has been a member of the Governor's Committee on Education in the state of Florida, responsible for their signing conference. He's currently serving on the Council of State Governors. Dr. Robert Gage received his undergraduate and graduate work at Syracuse University, spent many years working with exceptional children, went to the State Department of Education in Florida some 10 years ago, last served as the coordinator of National Defense Education Act and special programs for the state. He is a member of innumerable committees. He has been on innumerable boards. He has had innumerable citations of achievements, and which I will not even try to indicate to you. He has been a member of the Governor's Committee on Education for the state of Florida, responsible for their signing conference. He is currently serving on the Council of State Governments Committee on Data Processing. And just recently assumed the role of Director of Education Operations for Philco Ford in Philadelphia. Assumed the role not more than 3 weeks ago. Again, I could go on about a number of things about Bob, but I think that what you're going to hear is the call that we're about to introduce Dr. Robert Gage. Bob? This array of distinguished colleagues in front of me makes me feel as though perhaps we should have many more workshops so that folks like Bill and Stan and others have a chance to get together kind of out of the shop to talk a little bit. I think we've probably done more real honest talking over some juice and some milk and a few other things since we've been here in the last few hours and we've had a chance to do within the professional framework in a long time. And behind these lies a concept of folks like you and me getting together and doing some talking so that we don't rediscover the wheel every 20 minutes if we can possibly avoid it. And I think of the fact that in this room several of the people that kind of put their professional names on the line a very short time ago and said we've got to have a matrixy in which we can talk to each other about this thing we call processing or technology or automation and education or all the things we call it. And AIDS was born literally because of some of the folks in this room. And it's real difficult for me to express to you the kind of special feeling inside Bob Gage as I look out on the third workshop and I perceive what getting together and talking about where we are and how we're going to get that next tougher step down the road really takes place. Because as educators and people within corporate images and university kinds of personnel and technological people and technicians, we still have to do this getting together, and we have to sit down, and sometimes it isn't just there in the next couple of seconds or milliseconds or anything else. It's got to be thought through one more time before we go to that school board. And I have some deep feelings about the whole area of processing information about education. Part of this, I suspect, grows out of the fact that, depending on how you count, the Gages either have 7 or 9 children. We have 7 of our own, and about 2 years ago, on a promise that I made to an old and faithful retainer that had been with the Department of Education in Florida for some 34 years, he was a standing member of the Department of Education. He's been the mailman and then kind of general counselor to everybody else. I promised him that I'd see that his grandson was raised and educated if anything happened to him. And so we took on a charming boy who kind of looks very manly to me, as I see him in his first year of college this year. He stands about 6'2 and a half, he weighs 240, wants to be a theoretical mathematician. He got the highest score of any Negro youth in our state in the 12th grade test last year. And he was all-conference tackle. Now, you can imagine roughly what some of the universities in this country have been saying to me as his adopted father about where he ought to go to school. Because someday you will sit home on Sunday afternoon and see him play pro ball. If nothing happens to him, I'm convinced of this. He's a good football player. He's also a very good person. He's a person who has lived through part of the social change that we've got to look at and translate to information. Admittedly, he sat down in my office night and done most of his homework because for a period of time where he was housed, didn't have the facilities that were needed for late study. Someday I want you to meet Ryan. I think that one of the entertaining parts of our family is to see one of my older girls introduce Raleigh because he's as black as he is his face. And say, this is my brother. And then watch the shot take hold. In introducing me, Jay indicated that for a number of years I devoted my educational energy to that area that we call education of exceptional children, or special education, or this type of thing. And I feel as though I came home last night when I finally got into Salt Lake City because five consecutive summers, while Ellen Teal was on the campus of the University of Utah, I shared with you folks of Utah many wonderful, special kinds of things about what's inside people and how we really handle data up into Willie and what a home visitor really can tell you about what's going on in that family when you don't know. And where you're really going to do something in the Murray School District or the Georgia School District, and just how folks down at Point of the Mountain feel about the institution around the corner. And I thought I was going home last night. Because I think that whether you accept it or not as DuPont, whether you accept it because there are many here from other sovereign states, the Intermountain States representing one-third of the geographical area of the United States and 5% of its population have unique kind of special things that are necessary in educational information handling. I couldn't help but think as Bill was responding this morning to one of the questions about how big do you have to be before you get some of this stuff? How each of us who have fought the battle in the last decade would respond to this question. Bill did admirably. He said it's an unanswerable question if you don't know some more things. You see, this is the way we have gotten in education. We say we can't answer because we don't know. Got to have more information or I've got to qualify what I say 14 times. And we haven't got that much time. And we know it because we got school boards and taxpayers associations and university study groups and regional laboratories and everybody breathing down our necks saying, tell us, tell us, tell us. And they mean now. The interesting thing is, us good teachers don't know now most of the time. We know how we do it. We know that we socially promote children because they got a twinkle in their eye. They were here to set a criterion to move from third grade to fourth grade, and this young'un didn't need it. But he gets moved because he met this set of criterion over here. The problem is he didn't get around to defining this set of criterion. Maybe his father was president of the school board, and this is a good reason to promote him. And let's not overlook that twinkle in the eye is a good reason to promote him. And us educators do it, we just don't want to, for some reason, say we do it. So we need to have new information, not to tear down and take away from us our ability to do what we do well, but to do it a little better. Last year, a judge called. Because of my efforts in special education, I am on the other end of the telephone to a lot of people that try to work with difficult children. This judge said, I got a boy who's run away from home 13 times this last year. He said he's in real trouble. He's so fouled up in school that he just hasn't got a chance. He said, I think he's a good youngster. He said, what do we do with kids like this? Children. I said, we'll adopt them. So we brought into our home an 18-year-old youngster who came with a black leather jacket, a guitar, a motorcycle, and long blonde hair. And you can call it Gates' Job Corps if you want to, or you can call it a variety of things, but I learned an awful lot. My charming wife, Virginia, probably did more to get this boy reoriented to the fact that adult females do have some worth in the society. And the seven youngsters that he was merged into had a real interesting time with him because he ran into a number two daughter who is an acrobat with the circus. She's one of the few girls that does three somersaults to a catch from the high trapeze right now. And he made a pass at her about the second day. And he landed flat on his back. And he got up and started at her again, and he went back on his back because she has a brown belt in karate. And she says, now, you know what? We can go on like this all day. But she said, if you really want to impress me, get up and put on a clean shirt and cut your hair. And that will impress the hell out of me. And he did. Then he ran into a 14-year-older who stood roughly 6 foot tall and who had competed as a freshman in the state mile and come in 4:24 in second place, which isn't bad for high school freshmen, and who has had unusually good success with his academic work in school, who plays football, basketball, and baseball well enough to have lettered his freshman year. He also has done 100 ornithological plates for the Audubon Society. He's developed a lot of equipment to make life easier for the family. It's an interesting boy. We're real proud of him. But here was this 18-year-old that wasn't 6 foot tall and wasn't a fast runner and wasn't academically sound, and he just had to kind of find out how to live with that boy. And together they did some other remarkable things. So it's been an interesting year from that vantage point. Our oldest gal is a linguist and speaks a number of languages and reads and writes a lot more and plays oboe in the symphony and has a couple scholarships to school here and there, traveled abroad by herself. A youngster with average intellectual ability that uses it pretty well. Now, what I'm trying to say about educational data systems is this. The way you and I collect information today would make these youngsters look alike. They live at the same place. Within reason, they have the same mother and father, with the exception of the two adopted youths. With seven in the family, they've worn the same clothes, and they've taken the same courses or been took by them. They've had the same teachers, and they've gone to the same school. And the way you and I put information down and tried to do something with it to improve education today makes these youngsters look alike. And I suggest for your consideration they're different. The problem that you and I as educators face is that they're going to be even more different if they are going to be successful. I can remember spending a couple weeks back up in Tooele, turning to some of the kinds of information gathering that needed to be done one summer around here. And I found a lot of families back up in there that's gotten all mixed up along the way. And to me, this seemed real important. To the home visitor that was trying to make a good Mormon out of me, it didn't seem nearly as important. But collectively, we came out of there with a lot of information that Sterling Harris and I found able to do a lot of things with that I think made a better school system, in addition to that fine swimming pool they got up there. Why? because inside the information was the basis of a sound system of education. This is what we're really trying to build. We're not trying to talk about computers as some monsters that aren't going to go away, and they are. They're here to stay. And people like to talk about the technical side, including Bob Gates, and some of this kind of gear that we've got today. We say things about it like it's the first machine on the horizon that stretches men's minds and shows their muscles. And it does. And it lets you do kinds of things that you can't do without it. As a matter of fact, it will carry on some kinds of instruction, properly tooled up and put together with an emphasis on education, better than teachers can do it. When people say, you trying to put teachers out of work? And I say, yes, I am. They're overworked as it is. I'm trying to take out of their lives the things they don't do well anyway and give them time to teach. Because if there was ever a period in our history as educators when we need master teachers, it's right now. People who are really thinking about the fact that the end of the string, I think, that our house is 8 years old. Has a life expectancy, even though he's a hapless male, and you gals know you're more emotionally stable, less susceptible to disease and all that sort of thing than us hapless males. But even though he's a hapless male, has a life expectancy of 90 years. And at half life, or 45 years of age, will be in the year 2000. And in terms of the year 2000, that youngster won't be dealing with just twice as much information as he's got. When we talk about the next 3 years, we'll get as much new information as we got from the year 1800 through to soon. And by the time he finishes high school, we will have multiplied four times all human knowledge. By the time he's 45, we'll have 14 times total human knowledge that he'll have to wrestle to the ground if he wants to be a successful, operative part of a free society of free men. And this is true. Oh, yeah, we love to dabble in figures and statistics. And you can say, where do you get your facts? And I'll be happy to give you where I get them. But the issue is, this is happening to us. And we are moving towards a time when we better answer to legislators as to how much money we need to build within a system of education the kind of record keeping that provides for some degree of confidentiality between teachers and students about what kind of learning is going on, but simultaneously says to that legislature the reason for kindergarten, the reason for preschool education, the reason for vocational adaptive centers, the reason for these things are the tears of students of people that are moving through education today that have to be served. Why is the attrition at the University of Utah, one in every four people finishes college, that starts college? Why? Is it because we haven't passed on satisfactorily the kinds of information that the university personnel are entitled to have, so that youngsters can go through a series of studies within the university framework and be adequately prepared for a society with new information and maybe new postures? In assuming my new responsibilities recently, I suddenly found that I was responsible for about 3,500 personnel spread around the world. These people are doing all sorts of interesting things, and they are part of a complex that you and I, as educators, better start being real cognizant is there. Because you see, in the overall picture, in excess of 80% of the money spent by the federal government for education is not under the direct and sometimes not under even the advisory control of education. Maury Ullman's study recently made of the U.S. budget showing that $22 billion of last year's budget that could be attractively directed towards an educational function, that a very small portion of it was under the control of what we think of as our colleagues in education. Why? Not because you've had to add, perhaps, to your larger systems represented here, some real fine young people that don't have teaching credentials, that want more pay than teachers that have served 20 years to run those GD machines. but you better pay it. And you better face up to the fact that there's a new brand of cat in the education family. And you're going to have a lot of different kinds of kittens pretty soon. Because us educators, we're going to rub off on that technician, you know? The interesting thing is he's going to rub off on us. He's going to say why, and how, and when, and where, and then start over again with why. And he's going to say, yeah, that's a real good correction room, but how much does it cost to teach the letter A? If you just tell me that, I can do all this programming back this other way, you know? If you just tell me, how much does it cost to teach a youngster to read the word cat? You see, we haven't been thinking in a dimension of cooperative interaction with the society of free men. And for a lot of reasons. Disregard corporate if you want to, but I hope we stay as a capitalistic society. Because you see, today a third of the world is free. About 1 billion people. And a third of the world is slaves. About 1 billion people. And a third of the world is trying to make up its mind which it's going to be. Now, through the missions of the Church of the Latter-day Saints, from this very community and the rest of Deseret has gone hundreds of bright boys and girls to reach out across this country and other countries to talk about our dimensions of democracy, to talk about a fundamental faith in a creator, to talk about doing right by your fellow men. But this has to be multiplied, whether we do it within the bowels of religious endeavor or whether we have to come along and support this by other kinds of programs. Why? Because 900 million of the 1 billion people that are trying to make up their mind whether to be slave or free today in this world speak Japanese, Chinese, Russian, Portuguese, Arabic, and Hindustani or Hindi. Now, how many of us in this room are ready to effectively communicate with this 900 million people that understand those languages? And what do your people tell you within the Church of the Latter-day Saints when they come home from their missions about the need to talk about the goodness which is in our land? We got riots. There's been times when I've been considered an expert. When needed a mediator, you know who was expendable at that particular conference. Last year, we had 47,000 Cuban youngsters show up on our shores. The interesting thing was not that we got them into school, and not that we found ways to use educational technology to seriously improve the lot of how we measure these youngsters and how we as educators dealt with them. The real gut-level kinds of questions were, do you teach them Cuban history or American history? Do you expect to keep them, or do you want them to go home? And you see, there's some kinds of things that are real problems if we get all the paperwork out of the way that we as educators have to answer. And without an educational data system in machine-usable form and the interlocked use of information shared openly between public and private, I mean what I say, we aren't going to be ready to meet the onslaught of maintaining what happens to that third of the world trying to make up its mind what it's going to be. Now, how do we do this? Well, we do a lot of things. We talk to legislators. Their initial impact, and I hope perhaps, although I didn't recognize any of them present, I hope perhaps some of you folks either aspire to be legislators or have been or know some. They will come at this in all probability, the fact that computers are getting expensive in government, as is data processing equipment. And so their study and feasibility and analysis will be pointed at how can we reduce the amount of energy that the state of Utah has? Not how do we use it effectively. Bill answered this morning by saying 5 years is a good point down the time when feasibly you can say, okay, now you're making about the same amount of money that you would have made if you hadn't done this to begin with. I don't take issue with Bill on this. I just share with you my general conclusion that you can't run away from the computer unless you also want to deny fire and the wheel. And they're here to stay, too. And so is the computer. And it isn't something that is so complex and so involved. As a matter of fact, I was interested in the remark Mr. Davies, the point that I was sneaking in and out, and I assume he said this while I was out, because I didn't hear him say it. But in effect, when we built some of the big old tube models, less than 15 years ago. You see, we retired as antique and completely outmoded the first one that went in the sensor roughly 12 years ago. And this whole idea of being able to manipulate information in this form came into being, even though we've had the Hollerith card and a lot of other ideas before this. And I would share, since I saw some vendors present from an organization which has this particular device, that we have not only the hologram to look back to, but we have the hologram to look forward to. What is that? That's the ability to look at something inside. You know these balls we used to have in dance halls where the mirrors were on them and you flash a light and there were many, many mirrors and it moved around, moved spots on the floor, and this was atmosphere for the dance. Well, invaginate one of those. Think of it turned in upon itself with the mirrors inside and the place to get your hand inside it where you can put an object up and now the mirror can see the object and it can measure what the object is in shadow and light, and because the wire is fastened to the back of the mirror, it can rate there. And then it can bring it out and say, here's what the object looks like, and then you can drop it, that big ball of information, and pick up 1 millionth part of it and then run a laser over a photographic plate and pick it up, and at the end of the laser you got a three-dimensional image of what you put in the ball. Any implications for education? Yeah, we're not going to try to break masers and lasers into the elementary school tomorrow morning. But don't run away, because elementary teachers are going to be using this kind of equipment in 5 years. And it isn't something to be afraid of, it's something to control, as we think we have controlled the curriculum of the last 2 decades. And I ask you sincerely, have you? Or did a group of non-educators move off and write a program in physics that said, keep those educators out of here so we can teach kids? And did we or didn't we accept the MIT physics course in math across the country? And did we or did we not train up teachers to teach this particular way? And did children learn better? And do we have retrogression on the part of our teachers who, by not being reinforced, get further and further and further away after an institute kind of experience? And what are you as education administrators thinking about in terms of that library book that you need to order in terms of the feasibility of a data system? Because you see, who reads the book? And what's in the book? And whether it's educationally sound or proper or contributing to the learning concepts of boys and girls is the same piece of information that your purchasing agent and the librarian and half a dozen other people in your system need. And when you talk to your local school groups and legislators about feasibility, say, it's going to cost money. So does Medicare. And Medicare will bring upon the scene an interesting kind of thing in the next couple of years, because we haven't got enough doctors to go around. And so we're going to have to have medical aid at what people have referred to in the literature as sub-professional level. And we talked about teacher aid, and I'm talking about a package of ideas that say, yes, reduce the clerical problem through an educational data system. We know how to do this because most of the corporate groups that have built this equipment over the years basically aimed at what they thought the market was. And we were kind of the poor relations in education. We didn't have much money, and they kind of sneaked around long term, month or so from the end of the fiscal year, and say, how much you got left in your equipment budget? And the business manager or accountant or the bookkeeper say, well, you know, this somebody didn't use something, or she moved off, or she got pregnant. That gal has got all that money in there for that thing I didn't want to begin with, but it's in there. Maybe I can get a new printing calculator. And so through the business offices of education has come a lot of the gut-level development of data systems. Then over here was another person in guidance, and that person just was so full of guidance and found no time to shuffle papers, and they said, I got to do it faster. Shuffle them faster, that's all there is to it. And they moved to machines, and pretty soon they were back to counseling again. Because now they had not only the paper moving faster, but what? They had information. Actually usable information. How many of you got locked files in your administrative offices back there that nobody's pulled open in the last 6 weeks? How much floor space does that take up? Do you have a big enough office as an administrator in your system, or do people have to stand up when they come in to talk to you because you got 3, 4, 5, 6 files full of that stuff that nobody's looked at in the last 6 months? But you got to keep it right under your eyes. Baloney. One of the jobs that I was given about 3 years ago, when we decided to go into a large-scale microfilming operation in the State Department of Education, was to go around and very irregularly enter offices at night and put tapes on the back of files that nobody should know were there, and then go out again. And then we finally came in about 6 weeks later and we checked, and these files that everybody had to have right there, 60% of them hadn't been opened. I don't mean whether they took anything out or not, we had no way of checking. They hadn't even pulled the drawer open. The cleaner hadn't even moved them. You know, that would open the drawer to wax the floor. Let's stop kidding ourselves about the fact that we don't need what we're talking about in this workshop. We do need it. And we need to be in charge of it. And we need to stand up and say, I'm a teacher, and I need that equipment. And I want it just as soon as I can have it. And this begins to take a very different kind of pitch on feasibility. Because now you're not talking about the administrative cost that you can do. My boss, Tom Bailey, that used to be state superintendent in Florida, he said, you know, with enough green ice age and quill pens, I can go on making the same mistakes in finance forever and not really damage the school system of America very much. But if tomorrow morning a good idea about how to teach low-achieving, high-ability kids in the fourth grade gets away, I've done ultimate disaster to the education of this nation's children. And so we're really talking about what are the instructional implications of what we're doing with these systems we're trying to build. That's what we're talking about. Yeah, computer-assisted instruction. That's a nice term that we come up with to try to say we're not going to run any teachers off. I hope we run off the incompetent teachers, and I say so every time I meet with folks like you who are teachers. Because I don't think we're going to survive if we don't get rid of some of our colleagues who are incompetent and go on forever protecting them on the basic supposition that they're there and that I don't want them picking at me whether I'm a good teacher, so I'm going to leave them alone. How do teachers evaluate themselves and their system and their superintendent and their materials and their libraries and their guidance services and their special education services and a variety of other things? How do you do that without organized material? You don't. You may have a gigantic person in your leader, and some of the folks that I recognize in this room, I've been that to the Utah Education Association, and they've been that to systems within Utah. But you can't keep it up forever, and we can't multiplex you. Yes, there's a time coming when we're going to hook wires to people to try to get ideas, particularly youngsters who are very unusual, because we have to know some things that we don't know about how to serve these youngsters when they're injured or met with a given kind of pharmaceutical need or a medical need or a surgical need. And these things are going to happen. But this doesn't mean the end of the day of the classroom. This doesn't mean that we've got to continually be concerned about what am I doing wrong or how much money have I got to have before I can start. You've started. You've been collecting information for years. Now, admittedly, you could throw about 95% of it away this afternoon and run a better system because you've got more floor space. What I am asking you to do is look at all the efforts that are being made. I'm looking forward to the time when in the Intermountain States, with that 5% of the population and a third of the geographical location of the continental United States, you will have come forth upon the land either through the Four Corners program of the new commission or something with basic ideas about how do you work with the Ute Indians that are feeding into your system at the present time? How do you work with youngsters that have strong religious basic ground rules that come out of their homes that say, I can't handle that audiovisual equipment, or you can't teach my child that. And let's stop kidding. 39 of our states have passed a law that invalidates all psychological testing as we know it today, because it says fundamentally, number one, you can't teach a child germ theory, and number two, you can't measure him on a test that uses germ theory as any part of it, and he then can't be compared for other scores on the basis of any test which uses it. Quiet legislation by a very sophisticated group of people that has moved through 39 legislatures in the last 3 years. Interesting idea, isn't it? How does the guidance counselor deal with it? He forgets it and goes ahead and uses the psychological information that he has, of course. But suppose instead of a big riot about something, you had a case tomorrow morning that said you can't measure youngsters. Or the contrary of this, measure them, but you've got to make all of the records of the youngsters available to the community population. And I called your attention to 22 pieces of litigation that have happened in 16 states in the last 12 months with regard to what teachers and principals and superintendents have to give to the public out of your record system. And so AGE, as an association, has done what? Established a national group to work on the ethics of information and the ability to share and keep kinds of things that are necessary and throw away what we don't need as we move down the pike, and yet leave a record trail that not only helps the youngster moving on to the vocational area or the university area, but how about the gal that's just plain going to get married and start a family? Isn't there any reason to maintain some kind of information that will help this gal when 6 years from now she has to introduce herself to adult education because she's now got to cook on a stove that uses atomic power, and she's got to know how to use it and not be burned, and she's back in the learning process? This is what data systems are all about. This is what you're doing here today. Yes, we're going to get out payrolls, and we'll get them out faster, and we'll make mistakes. I'm reminded of the fact that one of the programs that we wrote called for information to be developed, which had previously been developed by hand. A wonderful old gal had been in the department for years. Every night she came back and redid by hand everything the computer had done for her all day. And the hours got longer and longer and longer. And we sat and we had a real professional ethical discussion of this whole matter, because we said, shall we see the machine a mistake and let her find it? And we ended up saying, no, let's not do this. It may make mistakes all by itself. Not often, but they do. But we don't throw them away because they make mistakes, because if we had to use that premise, we'd get rid of us in a hurry, wouldn't we? Each and every one of us have been known to make a mistake. Interesting, the ruling in Alabama the other day when the judge said you have to keep the machine as a person when it gives you the wrong size check. You read that in the paper? Gave a boy $1 million check. He took it back and said, this obviously isn't what I get paid every month. And they said, that certainly is right. And they supposedly did whatever adaptation adjustment was supposed to be made. And it came back through as $1 million, and he cashed it. And then he went to court. And the judge ruled you would not treat another human being that way. Fortunately, I spent most of the minute. Now, in effect, I'm asking you, as people in the Intermountain State, as people with one of the deepest ethic underpinnings that we have in our free society today, as people who are on the cutting edge, to seriously consider what it is you have been discussing here. Oh, I'm sure people have said things you didn't understand. They went either, you say, it went right over my head. Did it? Or did you decide when he used the word that you understood meaning something else that you weren't going to listen anymore because you didn't believe this whole thing anyway? Were you trying harder, or were you feeling in fourth place instead of second place? I'm serious. We as educators have got to be abrasive enough with the educational community within technology to survive. And I'm not threatening you, I'm just saying, let's get at it. Because we've all got to do it. Now, you've been cautioned by the speakers I've heard this morning not to rediscover the wheel every 20 minutes and to look around for people that are doing other things, and the AGE Association represents a way to get a lot of information in a hurry and a lot of things that will help you. But there's still things got to be done right here, because you got some old biddies back in that section and that section and in classrooms. I didn't say old maids. Old maids are men or women married or single that have lost hope. I said, old biddy. The kind of gal says, I don't believe. I've been teaching kids right here for 30 years, and I know what's good for them, and that's what I'm going to do. Somebody said that to me recently. A bit of verse that Jay mentioned, I used to think I wrote poetry, and then I got some real bright kids that write poetry, and then I discovered what I write first. But in that piece of verse, I say something about trust, you know, and this gal came up to me after the close of the presentation. She said, long and diligently in the schools of that state. She said, young man! And I liked her right away. I'm not one of those people that you're talking about. I trust at least one of my children every day. And I was about to say, she's an old bitch. And I ended up saying, thank God for old bitch. Because on the back of the person who questions what it is you're trying to do has been built the public school system of these United States. On the back of the person who, when you come back from that summer course and you're all filled with all sorts of good experiences and other things, in effect, he says, I don't care what you learned up that university, this is the way we teach kids right here. And you say, what would you do? And yet once convinced, the old biddies in your system are the bulwark of your data educational system in this new usable form. Because just take the time to convert one. Just take the time to convert a person who is ingrained in your system and has the generalized respect of other people in the education system, and see what happens to what you can do with various kinds of equipment. It isn't a matter of whose equipment. It isn't a matter of when you get it, almost. It's a matter that you go out of here in the next period of time and start moving to build in the change which has got to come in order for the Gates youngins and others to survive. Because I want to survive. I want us free, and I want that third of the world trying to make up its mind to be free. And I want to feed the world's population, as has been done by various groups in other times. And it's the religious inclination of our entire society, notwithstanding the inimical kinds of activity, can't do it, then we've got to find other ways to do it. And if the gear you've got will only handle administrative kinds of things, and the K, as these technicians call it, in terms of thousands, that you're going to be able to store pieces of things in it, and the K isn't big enough to do anything but the payroll, then move on to the next kind of thinking, so that when you put the next one in, maybe go right on doing that job on payroll on the old year. Take a good, healthy look at your system, and you'll see what I'm talking about. Just because some of this equipment is big, and just because some of it is expensive, isn't going to change the general way we as educators come to use it. But it's coming a lot faster than Edgar Morfitt and some of those boys that said it took 50 years to make a change. You know, Lyle John used to say that all the good things that had happened, especially in education the last 20 years, had come in through the basement. Boys, shower, school, lunch, and special education. I'm suggesting that there's been a halo effect, and some administrators have said, I got to get one of them things because he's got one. So don't. Don't get anything in your shop until you as an administrator are committed to a better tomorrow in education. Because you can go along the way you're going without the equipment. And if all you're going to do is have expensive electric page turners, don't bother. Children can turn pages and teachers can turn pages. When you're in the teachers in the group will realize that one of the problems I have is pronouns, and I've missed how many so far? Three. I had a wonderful English teacher when I came through school. She taught me to recognize mistakes after I made it. I don't know whether basically it's good or bad or sound or unsound, but I want the Gates youngins to grow up and have their children in a society that's free. And I want them to be able to go to the church of their choice. And I want their teachers to be able to have the kinds of materials that are necessary. And I want that system administered not economically, This is the biggest single fallacious idea that we have as educators. There isn't anything economical about the way we operate now. We are the greatest wasters of human energy that I ever know. We spend 99% of our time talking about our failures. How often do you stand up and hear somebody say, "I did a real good job with that youngster. Boy, you should see him go today." No. Billy just didn't get it again. I once tried to promote the publication of negative educational research because there's so much more of it, you know. If we just had that started so we could get on with the things that people do well instead of the things that we've all failed at doing. What am I really saying about a data system? We've got it. Now we're trying to put it into a confluence that will make it possible for the administrative strength of your program to join through special devices, people and things, with the instructional forcefulness of that same society. And you can't do it without this tool we're talking about. This just can't be done in living today's society. You can go along the way you're going. But believe me, you're going to have to accept the fact that this is here, and to say, isn't the big system that will always have the end, particularly in the Intermountain States. I know a high school in this great United States of ours where they have 850 youngsters and 3 computers. And they've moved on down the pike, and that, they call them the superintendent of schools, that principal, in effect, does everything but pick his teeth with those doggone things. But what is happening in that school? They've got more materials, and the community is involved, and they know what they're doing with their volunteers, and they have a good idea of where their financial structure is. Because every morning when he walks in, laid on his desk is an update of his entire budget as of 12 midnight the night before. How many teachers' days of leave are involved, and all the kinds of things he needs to know to make a decision. Now, you don't have to redo this. He's got it done. But you got to find some way to communicate with him, and that's what AIDS is all about, and that's what workshops are all about, and that's what people like Bob Gates are all about. Crying out for you to listen. Not be afraid. Listen. How did you learn most of what you know? By seeing it? Yes, you have some research that says you saw it. How do you take a chunk of a mountain out here when you got vision like that? How many of you read Mind for Peace, written by a girl in Salt Lake City, a Canadian who won the Canadian Writers Award, who sat and looked at these mountains for her inspiration? Born of missionary parents in Korea, brought here by Ellen Keel, suspended an arc of 1 degree at 22 feet and could see 6 inches wide at 22 feet in one eye, total visual acuity, taught a class of severely involved cerebral palsy children in Guelph, Canada, with braces and everything else. Yes, Jeannie Little is unusual, but read Mind for Peace, because what is in that book is an educational data system, not just about the census that you take in your class, because that's in there too. Not just about the kinds of things that happen in good classrooms with good teachers when students learn, but what happens in administrative complexes when principals are instructional leaders, when they have time to sit back because they know what's going on within their building. Yes, we spend a lot of time scheduling, and we have sure within the technical field spent hours trying to develop scheduling techniques. And someday soon, we probably will have a reasonable group of devices, and in a free society, more than one from which you can select the scheduling program. In effect, is the schedule the important thing at your school? Is that what makes or breaks the boy who you see go on to your state penitentiary? Why has Utah, with mutual and primary and all the things that your society has had to offer, had for a number of years the highest delinquency rate of any state in the Union? Proportionally speaking, why? I'm asking you, not as people who have got to respond and jump up and defend, but because down deep inside your heart, this is what is real to you. You want to change this. And you can't do it without modern technology. You can't do it just by loving kids, but you gotta love them. You can't do it just by shifting teachers around or changing schedule or making new curriculum or bringing somebody like Gates in from the outside to harass. You got to get inside and get to work. And it takes work, and it isn't easy. But the leader has to be committed. All of this, and I'm over time, I'm sure. Let me try and stay in a bit of verse. Because I believe in what I told you. And I believe you people in the Intermountain Station are the cutting edge of the American educational society. Because what you do out here with these far-flung little districts is probably the way we're going to solve urban problems. And you know it, and I know it. Because we ain't solving it the way we're going. And we can create all the new secretariats for housing and urban development and transportation and all the things that will help you get equipment in a couple of years, by the way, through your local community, if you want to merge with your local community and have educational information moving through their system. But that ain't the way it'll be solved. It'll be solved by new ideas being generated that can be communicated because they can be kept. The fourth grade teacher that effectively deals with low-achieving, high-ability children can very seldom teach what happened that day so that she can communicate it. And this is why we have spent so much of our lives trying to cure, but not as effectively as we can today with modern technology. I met a boy and girl a day or two ago. Oh, I'd heard about them, mostly bad and so-and-so. But when I met them, what I'd heard began to fade, because you see, in me, a very personal friend made me. We walked a bit and talked a bit, and finally just us three settled down to thinking as we sat down by the sea. And in the conversation ended, and their hearts lay bare, and friendship was the thing for which they had a fight. I think we're going to be okay, that boy and girl and me, because the hardest part is over, and we trust each other, you see. Some friends of mine the other day felt compelled to say they really had to confess the world was in an awful mess. As I was about to add my part to this discussion, sad, I stopped and looked where I stood and wondered if I really should. I wondered if through this chatter there was anything I could add that would really matter. If there was anything that I could say that would give us life one more day. And I guess I realized how this talk and materialized. We didn't know, and we were serious. So to our friends, our hearts be bare, and talk security for you and yours and mine and me. What was this thing that I thought for you and you thought for me, this wonderful thing, security? The group broke up with a sigh because its troubles would not fly, and then I knew what I must do. For what it's worth, I'll pass it on to you. I asked my God for me to pray that I might, in every way, in every word and action, bring about just a little more satisfaction. And we who are intelligent should say a prayer of thanks and never belittle those who fill the less developed ranks. For there is no glory in the wisdom we amass except as we employ it for the good of every class. The literary and the skilled who hold their noses high are not the ones whose lustrous stars will linger in the sky. They are the vain and selfish and the blind who cannot see that they are gifted only by God's generosity. But those who fear their wisdom and their lore possess the preeminence that will endure forevermore. So you trust each other, these new interlopers in the educational system called technicians. Did you trust the last school that sent this unable child to you in an unable way? Did you trust tomorrow as being a day of freedom rather than a failure? Would you be satisfying unto yourselves? Would you pray with and for your faculty, your staff, and your children? Would you share the gifts within this room and within me and the Mountain Area and within Utah and within your little old school district of any size? So that collectively you will know the satisfaction of having a youngster look up at you and spoken or unspoken, say, gee, I'm glad. You're my friend. Thank you very much.